Welcome back. In this lesson, we are going to have a look at an already pre-existing code. We are going to have a look at a smart contract. And we are going to use all of that we've learned so far in order to read, understand, and analyze this smart contract. And the smart contract which we are going to look at is one of the official smart contracts, which can be found on the official Ethereum website at ethereum.org under token. And this smart contract will give us the tools to create and build our own cryptocurrency. So we're just going to copy this code from the website to our text editor so it will be easier to work with. There we go. And one of the first things that you might see when you're looking at this code is that the style of this code might be somewhat different from what we have seen previously, from what we've written before. And it's quite important to understand that just like real life writers, literature writers, many coders have their own style of coding, their own style of writing smart contracts. And it's something we're going to see quite a lot. No need to get worried about it. Some code writer will prefer to write all of their function in a single line. Some will use more curly brackets than the other. Some will make sure that the indentation of the code, the spacing in the code, is more organized than other. Again, this is just something which every code writer, every programmer decides by himself. And all we need to make sure is that we do understand the logics of the smart contract. The styling, it's not so important, at least not most of the time. So don't get discouraged if you see a smart contract written in a way that you haven't seen before, because in most cases, it's only some sort of a personal preference, the way the coder itself decides to write the smart contract. So now I want us to have a look at the code itself. The code itself is only 66 lines. This is what it is required in order to create a cryptocurrency using the official Ethereum example for cryptocurrencies, for tokens. And we can see over here at the top that they are declaring two contracts. The first contract is token recipient. The second contract is called MyToken. And we can see that the contract MyToken is not token recipient. We do not see the sentence MyToken is token recipient. And when we see something like that, it immediately tells us that there is no inheritance between those two contracts. The contract MyToken will not receive any attributes from the token recipient contract. And when we see something like that, we need to ask ourselves, well, if there is no inheritance between those two contracts, then why are two contracts are defined to begin with? And the most probable conclusion for such a thing, for such a decision, will be that within the contract, my token, we should expect to see some sort of a function which will interact with the first contract, with the token recipient contract. And we don't know yet what type of functionality we should expect, but we know that there is going to be some sort of a connection between the two. Otherwise, the first contract, token recipient, wouldn't have been declared as part of our code. So again, we see two contracts. We see that there is no inheritance relationship between those two contracts. So we can safely assume that those contracts will interact with each other using some functions. And it is seen more likely that the contract MyToken will include some sort of a functionality which will allow us, the users, to interact with the contract or a contract of the type of the token recipient contract. And indeed, later on in this lesson, we are going to see that there is an interaction between those two contracts. And we'll see it later on. Now, another thing which is actually quite important to understand is that creating a cryptocurrency or creating a smart contract in general, every smart contract, every cryptocurrency, they might have their own type of functionality. We can create a cryptocurrency which will be completely different from what we've already learned. We might create a cryptocurrency when I can change the balance at will. I might create a cryptocurrency that will, let's say, reflect some sort of a real-life object, like, let's say, a cup of coffee. Let's say that I am the owner of a coffee shop. We can use it. We can use a smart contract in order to build some sort of a special currency for that specific coffee shop that can be used only in that specific coffee shop and nowhere else. We can decide that our cryptocurrency will be used only within a certain time limit. So the code that we are going to look now, this example for a cryptocurrency, this is only one of the ways a cryptocurrency can be made using Ethereum. There are many, many other ways to create a cryptocurrency in Ethereum. And it is very important to remember the example we are going to see now, even though it is official example from the Ethereum website, it is not necessarily the most usable example. This code is not necessarily the most usable code. This code is not necessarily the best code. It's not necessarily the most secure code. It's not necessarily the most easy to use code. This is only some sort of an example. And you will surely encounter many other type of cryptocurrencies if you continue to work with Ethereum, which will eventually look completely different from the code that we are looking at right now. And this is also a reason why these type of lessons are very, very important. You need to be able to look at a smart contract by yourself and understand the way it works, its mechanic, by yourself. So that was just a simple side note. Let's take a look at our contract now. We are going to have a look at the contract MyToken, and we can see that the contract MyToken has a constructor function. Now, just a reminder, a constructor function will have the same name as the contract. So the contract MyToken will have a constructor function, which is called MyToken. And this constructor function will be called only once when we deploy this contract, and the contract MyToken will not be deployed until this function has been called and executed properly. So this is our constructor. And let's go back to the top and let's see what are the type of variables that this contract, MyToken, is using. We can see that the first variable is a string, public string. It's called standard. And this string is hard-coded with the message token 0.1. Again, as I said earlier, the code might be changed. People might choose to add things to it, remove things to it. This is just some sort of a message that the coder, the one who wrote this smart contract, decided to insert into this smart contract. So if I'm going to create my own cryptocurrency using this smart contract, this cryptocurrency will have this message hard-coded into it, this message that says token 0.1. I can just change it to whatever I want. I can call it, hello, this is my cryptocurrency. I can even remove it altogether. I don't really need it in order to build my cryptocurrency. But this is what the writer of this smart contract chooses to use. So just choose to say that every cryptocurrency that is deployed, that is created using this smart contract, will contain this message, token 0.1. We can see that the next variable is a string, a public string called name. This will probably be the name of our cryptocurrency. And then we've got another string, public symbol. This will be used to provide some sort of a symbol for our cryptocurrency. Pay attention, this is also a string. It is not a logo or anything. This is just the symbol. Like for Bitcoin, it's BTC. Or for Ethereum, it's ETH. Or for the US dollar, it's USD, etc. Now, the next variable, the unsigned integer, 8 bits, this one is going to be called the decimals. It basically means to how many subunits I will be able to split my coins. The US dollar can be split to cents, and there are 100 cents in a single dollar, for example. But one Bitcoin, for example, can be split to Satoshis. So 1 billion Satoshis is one Bitcoin. And Ethereum can be also split into way. So 1 followed by 18 zeros of way is one Ether. And we can choose the denomination of the cryptocurrency that we are going to create. Maybe it's going to be like the US dollar, going to be split up to 100, no more than that. Maybe up to a billion. Maybe it won't even be allowed to be split at all. Maybe those tokens are just going to be used as some sort of a, let's say, a coupon for a coffee in my coffee shop. One coupon, one coin equals one coffee. That's also a possibility. I can also say no denominations at all. So this is about the decimals. And the next variable, it's the unsigned integer, 256 bits. It will represent the total supply, the total amount of coins which will ever exist. Again, maybe there's going to be 1 million coins, maybe there's going to be only 5 coins. It's up to me to decide, but whatever will be the total amount of the coins, it will be stored in this variable, total supply. The next two variables are arrays. The first variable, balance of, is an array which uses an address as the index of each individual cell, and within each individual cell, we are going to store an unsigned integer, 256 bits. And this integer will represent the balance, the amount of coins that the owner of the address has. The second array, the allowance array, tells me that in this contract, I can define a child contract, and I can authorize or allow this child contract to use some of my tokens. This is the allowance. Now, pay attention that this is an array within an array. And the outer shell of the array, the first index of the array, is an address. This is my own private address. And when I will look in this array, under my own private address, I will find a list of other arrays which can also be indexed or can also be mapped with the address of the child contract. Maybe there is only one child contract, maybe there are 5 child contracts. That doesn't really matter, but each and every one of those child contracts can be found under my own address. And within each and every one of those child contracts, I will find an unsigned integer, 256 bits long, which will represent the amount of tokens that the contract in this child address is allowed to use. So this is the allowance array, which is an array within an array. And we will see it in action in a few more minutes. The last item on our agenda, this is an event. This event is called transfer, and basically it will give some sort of a message to the outside world. It will give some sort of a notification to the people who are following my contract. It will basically contain the address of the sender, which is from, the address of the receiver, which is to, and the value, the amount of coins which are transferred during this transaction. And we can see that both the from address and the to address can be used as an index. That means that whoever will watch this contract from outside of the blockchain will be able to look for those specific addresses because they are the index addresses. So this is it about the event transfer. And now that we know what variables we are using, let's have a look at our constructor function, at my token function. We can see that this function asks the user to insert 4 arguments: the initial supply, the token name, the decimal units, and the token symbol. We can assume quite easily that the initial supply should be stored within the variable total supply, that the token name should be stored into the variable name, that the token symbol should be stored into the variable symbol, and that the decimal units should be stored into decimal, into the variable decimals. But the first line, balance of the message sender equal initial supply, that might be not so obvious. The main idea behind this line is that the one who create this cryptocurrency, the one who create those coins, will be the one who will receive all of the initial amount of coins. If I create 1 million coins, my address will be the address that will receive those million coins. And then I'm of course free to send it to other people if I want to. But my address will be the address which will get the initial amount of the coins. Okay, so finally we have the cryptocurrency. We have declared the variables. We know how the constructor function works. And let's see what type of functionality this cryptocurrency have. And we consider the first function is called transfer. Pay attention, this is transfer with a lowercase t, not to be confused with the event transfer, which we saw earlier. The event transfer has a capital letter T, a capital T. Event, capital T, function, lowercase t. Not to be confused. Anyway, this function transfer asks the user, the one who uses this function, to insert two arguments. To insert the two address, the address of the receiver, and the unsigned integer, 256 bits, which will represent the value. And now we can see that in order to transfer this money, an if statement is used. And the first if statement checks for the following. If the balance of the message sender, of the one who executed this function, is lower than the amount of coins that he wishes to send, then just throw him out. By the way, over here you can also see some sort of a difference in the style. When we have used the if statement in the previous lesson, we've used it with curly brackets, like so. And you can see that the coder of this code chooses not to use the curly brackets. This is, of course, his or her decision, and it will only affect the style of the code, but it won't change the way it works. So let's move along to the next if statement. The next if statement. This is a bit more complex and a bit less intuitive, but what it will basically do, it will look at the balance of the receiver of the two address, and it will say, if the balance of the receiver plus the amount which we want to transfer to this address will be lower than the current balance of the receiver, then throw. Why don't you make sure that the new balance is not lower than the original balance? Well, there are some way to make some sort of an attack on integers. It is something which is a bit more complex, so I'm not really going to talk about it in these lessons. But sometimes, even an unsigned integer can be fooled to contain numbers that it shouldn't actually support them. We said that the unsigned integer will never include negative numbers, so I won't be able to send someone -5 coins. But there are some way to fool the unsigned integer and make it contain numbers that it shouldn't. So this is some sort of a security mechanism to make sure that no matter what, the value will always be a positive number. There will be another security checkpoint, and that checkpoint will be to make sure that the balance of the receiver plus the new value will never be lower than the original balance of the receiver. So this line over here, this is another type of a security mechanism. Again, there are many types of attacks and there are many types of way to implement security into your contract. It is a bit more of a complex topic, but this is a good example on another way to make sure that no matter what, nobody will be able to drain the account of the receiver. The next two lines are very straightforward. First, it will look at the balance of the message sender, and it will reduce the value, the amount of coin that needs to be transferred. Pay attention, they use the minus equal sign. This is a more stylish way to just say subtract a number after the value has been reduced from the address of the sender. It will be added to the balance of the receiver. And the last command in our function is to send the event transfer to notify anyone who watches this contract that the message sender send to the receiver _2 and a specific amount of coins represented as _value. And now anyone who watches this contract can see that the transfer was completed. He can see who sent these tokens to whom and how many tokens were delivered as well. So now it's time to look at the next function. The next function is approve and call. This approve and call function, this is the first time when we're actually going to interact with this allowance functionality. As I told you, this smart contract, this cryptocurrency, the creator of this cryptocurrency wanted to put some sort of an extra functionality to this currency. It's not just that you will send and receive the coins, but you can also set an allowance. You can allow a specific address, a specific child contract, to use a predefined amount of the token that you will allocate to this child. I have 50 coins and I want to give 5 coins to one of my child contract. Then this child contract will be allowed to use 5 tokens for my own balance. Now this function takes 3 arguments. The first argument is the spender address, the address of the spender. The spender is the child contract. The second argument is an unsigned integer. This is the value. And this is the amount of tokens which I allow the spender, the child contract, to use. The third field, the bytes argument, extra data. We haven't talked about it yet. But currently in Ethereum, it is very hard to send a string of information from one contract to the other. Whenever I try to use variable that its size has not been predefined in advance, it will not go through, at least not at this stage. So a way around it will be to use the bytes field. This field will allow me to send my message as a string of bytes. I don't really recommend to try and do it, but if you are on the testnet, which I highly suggest that you will, don't use the mainnet for your smart contract until you are 100% sure that you know what you're doing. So at least while doing this tutorial, make sure that you are using the testnet. Then it might be actually a good exercise for you to see how you can play a little bit with these fields. What will happen if you change these fields from, let's say, bytes to string? What will happen if you will keep it as bytes, but we leave a very, very long messages as well, or a very short messages? This is a good exercise. You might learn a lot from it. Just make sure that you are using the testnet and not the mainnet. Now you can also see that this function, this approve and call function, also returns a value. And this value is a Boolean, and it is called success. We didn't really return a value so far, because we didn't really need it to. And in the context of this cryptocurrency, I think this is quite irrelevant as well. But the creator of this code decided that whenever a function completed its execution, the user, the one who sent this function will also get some sort of an indication. In our case, this indication is going to be a Boolean named success. And if the function was completed, we will get that success equals true. That means that the function has completed. We won't get it in a notification, but if we have a more complex type of smart contract, we will be able to use this Boolean success or maybe store it in a variable. Now, the first thing that this function will do, it will look at the allowance array. Remember, the allowance array is the array within an array, and it will look for the address of the spender of the child contract within the cell, the array cell, with the address of the sender of the message, of the one who uses this function. So it will look for the address of my child contract within a cell of an array that can be found under my address. And once it will find this address, the address of the child contract, which is under my own address, it will assign it with the value which we have inserted, the underscored value. And now the next two lines. This is again something that the developer of this cryptocurrency decided that we should use. He wants to make sure that whenever we authorize a child contract to use or to spend some of our tokens, that child contract will receive some sort of a notification, some sort of a message. And the way it is done, it is by using the first contract we've seen above. Now we can see that the contract of the child, of the spender, which is also called token recipient, has a function called receive approval. And this function won't do anything at all, except for receiving some information from the my token contract. The information that this receive approval contract will receive will be a form, a value, the address of the token itself, and some information, which is the extra data. So in order to use or in order to interact with a predefined contract, we just declare it as if it was a variable. So we're going to say token recipient. We are going to call this token recipient spender. We can call it whatever we like. We can call it just child or whichever way we want. And then we say that this token recipient spender is equal to the token recipient contract that can be found in the address of the underscore spender. This is the address which we have manually inserted. Once we have declared this variable, this object, spender, we can just use the built-in function in this spender object, which is the receive approval. Remember, the receive approval was defined in the token recipient contract. So the spender object can call this receive approval, and it will do so by sending it the message of the sender, the message of the one who executed the function, a specific value, which is the amount of token that this child contract is allowed to spend. This over here in pin, we can also see this. This is basically gives you the address of the contract which the cryptocurrency is a part of. So this will be the address of the cryptocurrency. And the last field is extra data. Once again, I suggest that you will leave it empty. And when we are a bit more comfortable with Solidity, then you can just play with it a little bit on the testnet through the process of trial and error. It will teach you a lot on the way the Ethereum protocol works. But for now, just leave it empty. And this is it about the approve and call function. So we are only left with one more function that we can call. This is the last function that we can call. This function is called transfer from. And this function is basically the same as the original transfer function to take the same type of arguments, but it will be used, or it will be called, in cases when the child contract tried to send some of the tokens which he allowed to send, some of his own allowance. So you can see that the arguments are going to be quite similar. You're going to have the address from, the address to, and the unsigned integer 256 for the value, just as in the transfer function. This function will also return a Boolean success, which will be used to indicate whether this function was completed successfully. And the first two lines are going to be exactly the same as the first two lines of the transfer function. It's going to check if the balance of the sender account has the needed value. It will check. It will use this security mechanism to make sure that the balance of the receiver will not be drained by some sort of an attack or by some sort of a malfunction in the value property. And the third if, this is the only different if statement in this function, will be to make sure that the sender of this message, the sender of this message, don't forget, is the child address. It's going to make sure that the child address is even allowed to use this amount of tokens. And it will do so by checking that the value which we have manually inserted in the execution of this function is not greater than the allowance which we have allowed for this contract. And if the child contract is not allowed to send the amount of token that it wishes to send from the parent contract, which is represented in this example as underscore from, then it will throw the transaction. Otherwise, it will change the balance of the from and the to account, just as it did in the previous function, in the regular transfer function. From the balance of the underscore from, it will remove the value, and to the balance of the receiver of the underscore to, it will add the value. And it will also update the allowance array, so that now the child contract will have less coins that it is allowed to use. For example, if I said that the child contract is allowed to use only 5 coins, and you just used 4 coins, now the new cell in the array, which represent the child contract, will be said to be only 1. He was allowed to use 5, he used 4. Now 4 needs to be subtracted from the 5, and so the child contract is allowed to use only 1 more token. You can see that we also use the transfer event. Pay attention, it's a transfer with a capital T. That means it will be used as an event. And this event will send a notification to anyone who watches this contract. And this notification will contain the address of the parent contract, the contract from which we have extracted the coins. It will contain the address of the receiver of the coin, and it will contain the value, the amount of the coins that were transferred. And of course, if everything works as it should, this function will return a true value, which will set the Boolean success to be true. And basically, this is it. We've just been to all of the functions which are supported, which can be executed in this code. So we have only one last thing which we haven't talked about. This is the unnamed function, the anonymous function. This unnamed function basically means that if a user will try to interact with this contract, with my contract, without using one of the predefined functions, either transfer, transfer from, or approved and call. It will be rejected. That user will be thrown out. No interaction with my contract will be accepted unless it is in the form which have been specifically defined. Those three functions: transfer, approve and call, and transfer form. And this is it. Basically, right now we've looked at the code of a smart contract. We've learned this code. We saw how this code can be executed. We've walked through the mechanism and the logic of this code. And this is basically something which I believe most people who are going to use smart contract should be able to do so. It is okay if you don't understand a sentence over here or maybe some sort of a logical operation. You can always find someone to ask. You can ask at our forum. You can ask on the internet. You will eventually find the answer for your question. But you should have some basic understanding on what is a smart contract and how to approach a smart contract, how you can read it, what to expect a smart contract to do, etc. So that was it. And I wish you best of luck. And again, if you have more questions, don't hesitate to ask. This is the best way to learn. Formulating a question and then finding a solution to that question is the best process of learning. And I wish you best of luck. Goodbye.